1952, a rebuilt and bustling city. The capital of England was once again its prosperous self following World War II, with new towns, more products, and bigger and better industrialization. But so often with change come many unintended consequences, and London was about to feel the wrath of one that winter. Wherever the sea may happen to be,
the sailor is found knocking around. If you had told me as a child that there were places outside of London with clear skies and sunshine almost every day, I would have said you were lying. The fog just seemed so unescapable. That's just how prevalent it was.
I remember my father telling me about how the fog was even in London before the Second World War. The fog had been here for so long, and now it was what people had come to expect. We'd been living with this fog for years and years. It was a part of our normal life now, and so nobody, not a single person, expected what happened at the end of 1952 to happen.
The fog was a staple of London coming into the winter of 1952, and the answer as to why revolves largely around one item, coal.
How you work inside all day long, when you come out you hear that?
Following World War II, the British government had sold their better quality coal to fund themselves in an effort to rebuild, keeping the more sulfurous coal to use themselves. This was the beginning of the worst of the London fogs.
Whenever my family would ever get a little chilly, we would shovel coal into the furnace. We didn't think anything of it. You know, everyone did it at the time. If you were cold, that's how you got warm. And we did it a lot.
Not only was the coal being used to light furnaces, but also every day to keep power stations, factories, and public transport systems running. As every day passed, more and more pollutants were being produced, making the London fog worse and worse.
I remember that winter in 1952 being one of the coldest I've ever been a part of. Seemed like we never stopped shoveling coal into that furnace.
That oddly cold winter led to increased coal usage that set up the stage for what came next, an anti-cyclone, on December 5th of 1952. A layer of warm air covered London, trapping the cold and polluted air inside, a process that is referred to as temperature inversion. Without the usual 5 to 10 mile per hour winds, there was nothing to disperse the polluted fog. London had quickly become a toxic bubble.
The first time I noticed it was actually because of its smell. It smelled like rotten eggs, and it seemed to seep through our walls into our house.
I remember when I looked outside, and usually it was during the daytime, so usually you could see things pretty well still, even with the usual fog. But not today. Today I just looked outside, and I saw nothing but a blanket of white.
London was consumed with smog so thick it wasn't possible to see farther than a few feet, if even that. Transportation quickly became restricted, some even leaving their cars behind in the middle of roads. Schools were closed, sports games cancelled, and crimes were at a high point, emboldening criminals vanishing easily into the darkness.
It was chaos out there. You couldn't see anything. The fog was so greasy it felt like you might slip at any moment, and you felt like you were constantly choking. It was a never-ending nightmare. Even when you got home, your skin was colored black by the air. It was truly terrible.
The fog lasted until December 9th of 1952, 5 days in all, after wind swept the polluted air into the North Sea. The effect it had on London was great, even though many did not realize just how large the effect was at the time. 150,000 hospitalizations and a total of 12,000 deaths occurred due to the Great Smog of London. as well as thousands of animal deaths.
The Great Smog of London was a terrible thing, and I think all of London knew that. We didn't maybe know the exact number of injuries from it or the exact number of deaths, but we knew there was a lot, and we knew that if we didn't want something like this, something so terrible, to happen again, then change was going to be needed.
It would take 4 years for that change to come. Fog had been a common occurrence in London, and the British government thought there was no immediate sense of urgency to change anything. Finally, Parliament passed the Clean Air Act of 1956. The act restricted the burning of coal and domestic fires, established smoke-free areas throughout the city, and granted homeowners heating options outside of coal, including electricity and natural gas.
The Clean Air Act of 1956 was a little bit frustrating because it was really slow. You know, we were kind of hoping that, you know, after 4 years after the Great Smog, we were just kind of hoping that the fog would go away or we could fix it and have it gone the next day. But it took a long time for the fog to actually start clearing up because the Clean Air Act was very gradual. It didn't just make the fog go away. It was a gradual change. It just felt very slow, and that's because it was very slow.
It was so slow that other deadly fogs occurred, including one in 1962 that killed 752 people. While none of these fogs were close to the scale of the Great Smog of London, they were still a problem, and eventually another Clean Air Act was passed in 1968. Today, the gradual changes started by the Clean Air Act of 1956 have finally panned out. The foggy days of London are gone.
Red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
What the Great Smog of London did for the world when it happened was large. Who knows how many cities, states, or maybe even countries saw what happened and changed their own ways because of it. There may not be some sort of specific statistic on that, but what we do know is it was a major event, and people heard about it, and people knew why it had been caused. It taught the world a lesson then, and it's still teaching that lesson today. What we do has consequences, whether good or bad, and we need to focus on those consequences when we create something. We can't just focus on ourselves. We have to build a relationship with nature. We have to learn how to work with our environment rather than against it. Even today, we can see the same types of problems happening, such as in climate change and even like in overfishing. We have to find a way to work together with the world around us. The Great Smog of London showed what happens if we don't. We need to take that lesson, the lesson that we can't expect the negative things we do to not have consequences, and put it into play in our lives today and our lives going forward. Perhaps if we can do this, if we can work with the environment rather than against it, maybe, just maybe, our world will never be shrouded in fog again.
I think to myself, what a wonderful